you see here, this is a data set of certain marks out of 20 for certain topics in HTML, HTML basics, HTML table, and HTML form. In these three topics, the teacher has taken the exam, and out of 20, the marks have been given here. Now, when we talk about mode, we talk about how many times a number has appeared in the data set. If you talk about this HTML basic formatting, you see 1, 2, 3, 4. 11 is appearing 4 times. So the mode here is 4, but 12 is also appearing 2 times. So in what will happen, it's not necessary that one particular value would be multiple times. There would be more than one value. So such a data set is called bimodal or multimodal data set. So here also, if you see, this is a single mode data set. Only 7 is repeated 3 times. So the mode is 3 here. Here 8 is repeated many times, 1, 2, 3, 4 times. So the mode here is 4. Now just by the mode, how can we do analyze and do useful analysis with the data? So here teacher is analyzing the data. How many students have scored marks less than 8? How many students have scored marks between 8 and 12? And how many students have scored the marks above 12? So here teacher has made a sheet, a small sheet of analysis. This is the result of analysis from this data set. So teacher can easily figure out, okay, here teacher can easily find out on which topic that teacher has to focus more. And that is HTML table. Mostly the student have not understood. 6 students have performed below 8 score for HTML table. HTML basic formatting is quite in control. Class is going to perform well in that, in test. HTML table has to be explained again. And HTML form is also in control with little bit of rework. HTML forms can also be explained to the students again. But HTML table needs the much focus on explanation again to the students. So this is just by looking at the mode of the data, this analysis has come.
So when we talk about data science, what actually, we all are possibly, we all are computer teachers here. And when we go for programming or talking about fundamentals of computers, one thing which we talk about is data. And we have those definitions printed in the books that data is a raw piece of information that alone does not make any sense. So this is one's set definition of data. And then we learn, we teach our students that data is something which is input to the computer along with instructions. And those instructions tell the computer how to process or how to deal with that data. And depending on those instructions, the data is processed. And as a result, some useful output is generated. That useful output is called information.
So this is the basic premise over which we teach our students input process output cycle, and then we go for the programming of the computers. Now, how data science is different from this approach? We already have been teaching about data to the students, but there is a basic fundamental difference between the two, the data processing and the data science which we are going to deal with. So when as a computer teacher, you are moving into a classroom where you have to teach data science, things get little different. Basic things are same, but the approach changes. When we talk about data, it could be anything. It could be the name of a person. It could be the name of any object, place, a number, a figure, a date, any amount. It could be anything. So data, definition of data remains the same. The difference lies in what we traditionally teach about data and what we are going to deal with in data science for data is the term analysis. In computer programming, we take the data and process it. We program the computer to process the data as per the business requirement, as per the problem given in the book. To solve the particular problem, we write a program, we input the data, data is processed. In data science, if you wish, you can make note of things also. You can keep the pen and paper ready, and you can make note of important points which come across. However, the recording of this session will reach you anyway, so that's not an issue. Well, so what happens in data science, data is not processed, data is analyzed. Now, what is the difference between processing the data and analyzing the data? However, both generate some output. In data processing, we have the necessary data already available. We have the clean data available. And that clean, necessary data is put into the program. It is processed and some output is generated, which is useful. That we call information. But in data science, information, of course, is generated. But it is generated after analyzing the data. Now, programming and analyzing, let's understand this. Analyzing means looking at the data values which are there in the data set and trying to figure out how these data values are related to each other. Are there any patterns in the data values which are trying to tell us something? Am I going to make some decision on the data? Am I going to predict something out of that data? Can I figure out something out of the data which is useful for me? This is called data analysis. And data processing is actually applying certain actions on the data, basically calculations. So when we are applying some actions on the data, those are through some calculations, certain formulae. But when we are talking about analyzing the data, we are actually not processing it. We are looking at the data and then we are trying to figure out what kind of useful information this data is trying to tell me. And this is where our analytical skills come in. If you show a data set to one person and ask him, what can you figure out from this data? He might come up with certain conclusions. If you show it to some other person, he might be coming out with some different conclusions, depending on the richness, depending on the size of the data set. So this is how data analysis happens in data science. So data science actually deals with analyzing the available data, and there are two purposes. Number one, figuring out what information this data is trying to give us. This is called feature extraction or data engineering. In data engineering, we look at the data and then we try to figure out through analysis what story this data is going to tell us. The second aspect is we analyze the data to make it suitable for any artificial intelligence algorithm for further processing. So these are the two major aspects in data science. One is to whatever data you get, you analyze it and try to figure out what this data is trying to tell me. Second aspect is I give the data, I prepare the data for an AI algorithm so that AI algorithm can learn from that data and do certain necessary tasks. So these are the two major roads which come out of data science field. Now, when we say we analyze the data, one traditional way to analyze the data is our eyes and brain, of course. But in data science field, now today there are many software and many tools are there which help us in analyzing the data in a better way. For example, if you have the data in a tabular format, you have a spreadsheet of 100 records and 50 columns. Now, looking at that data and analyzing that data is not easy. You have to scroll across the screen. It's difficult. So there are tools. There are certain analytics tools which are available, analytics software, which are available to the professional data science professionals who use those tools to look at the data with different angles. So looking at the data through different angles, through different perceptions, is called data visualization. So data visualization is the technique to look at the data for the convenience of analytics, to analyze the data better. So this is where data visualization comes in. So if I have got some raw data, what I will do, I will try to create a graph out of that data. Now that graph is actually the visual representation of that data. So looking at the graph, I can easily come to certain conclusions compared to just looking at the raw data. So this is one example of data visualization. So the teachers who are going to teach this data science and artificial intelligence in their classroom, I would request them to prepare at least one basic tool, that is MS Excel. MS Excel, if we are teaching IT already, we are well aware of MS Excel. We do our tasks also in Excel, a lot of reports and data keeping we do. So you better get well versed with MS Excel, certain basic features, for example, sorting the data, filtering the data, creating different graphs on the data, knowing the use of a particular graph, why this pie chart is required, what pie chart cannot do, what a bar chart can do, where would I use histogram, where would a scatter chart would be useful. So different charts, pivot table, certain what if analysis tools are there, like pivot table is there, solver is there, goal seek is there. So these are the basic what if analysis tools you must practice. If you do not know, you can easily practice them. And you can watch the videos on YouTube, even our own channel Knowledge Work from EduSoft. That also provides you many videos which you can see and learn. So when you're going to teach data science, your focus would be on analysis. Data is not important. Of course, it is there. Analysis is important. It is the value of analysis, what you do with the data. And that comes with the practice. More you analyze different kind of data, your analytical skills develop. And if you use MS Excel in the classroom to demonstrate your analytical skills, students will be able to understand better. So whatever book you are teaching with might not be talking about MS Excel, but Microsoft Excel can be used as a teaching tool in a data science class. So that way it will be easier for you to explain certain concepts. And once you create certain demo, you can reuse it in your classes. So this is the basic difference between data science and basic data processing. Another aspect is, when you talk about programming, whatever data comes to us in the program, that is already cleaned data, that is the required data. My program says enter your name, my program says enter your age, and the input comes into the program either through the user or from a file, any which way. But what about data science? Data science, the purpose of data science, as I told you, to analyze the data and to make it appropriate for certain AI algorithms. So let us focus on the second aspect, making the data appropriate for AI algorithms. So whatever data in real life we collect for analysis is never available in the way we need it. So whenever you're trying to collect the data, you're doing some survey, you're downloading the data from a website, you're collecting the data from certain documents, or you have mined the data from certain database queries, whatever data you get, it is not in real life available always in the way you need. You have to rearrange the data. You have to look whether the data is suitable, whatever the values are there, are they relevant? You have to look what kind of data formats are being used. The data which you will collect, suppose dates, certain dates would be in different formats, another set of dates would be in a different format. So you have to rearrange those dates in the same format. The decimal places, the currency figures, the formats of currencies, formats of time, names might be having blank spaces. Addresses might be having blank spaces. Unnecessary data would be there. There would be some data which you absolutely do not need. Then there would be some data missing which you need. Those are called missing values. So these are all the aspects which make the data dirty actually. The real data is raw data which is not appropriate. We have to clean it. That is called data scraping or data tidying up or data cleaning. So one very important role of a data scientist is to make the data clean, to clean the data, to tidy up the data so that it is ready for analysis. So whatever data you collect, you cannot immediately start analysis with it. You have to make it tidy. You have to bring it into some shape and structure so that it is comprehensible. You can understand what is shown there so that you can create a graph on it, so that you can explain it to somebody, so that it can be fed into an AI algorithm. So prime thing is raw data has to be clean. After this, we move on to when we have the data ready with us, then we go for what is called data analysis. So analysis has two phases. The pre-analysis phase is actually you are analyzing the data to clean it. So when you're tidying up the data, you will be analyzing it. But the purpose of analysis is different. The purpose of analysis is here, the data should be valid, the data should be correct, the data should be, there should not be repeating values, data should not be redundant as per the requirements, the missing values should not be there. The data should be in required format. The data should be in required shape and layout, which I need. So these all things are taken care of in the pre-analysis phase. Once that is done, the data set is ready for analysis. So basically, when the data is cleaned up, it is mostly in 99% cases, it comes into a tabular shape, tabular format, where rows are there, and each value in the row is identified by some column name. They are called labels. You can visualize it in the form of a Excel sheet, where column names are there and rows are there. In certain cases, what happens, there might be some row headings also on the left hand side. You might have seen certain data where at the top the columns are also there, and on the left hand side usually other headings are there. So for example, if you have done a survey where you are talking about certain food preferences from males and females, so those food preferences labels will come on the column, and on the row side there will be two rows, male and female. So this way data can also be presented, but usually it is in the form of columns, where column headings are there and data is labeled that way. Like you prepare your spreadsheet for student marks. So that is one example of a clean data. But imagine you are collecting the data, you are the class teacher, and you are collecting the data from 10 teachers. Now those 10 teachers, if they are not following the data format rules set by the school, you will get sheets which are different. You might have that experience that people have entered the data in different formats, in different ways, and then you spend some time to arrange it, to make it proper, so that it is useful, it can be used. I think every teacher's experience might have been that. So this is the basic touching on data science. Why data science? What is the basic difference between data science and data processing? Now we move on to what actually we do with the data in data science. Now that comes to the core of the course. If you're teaching data science, students will ask, they will expect what to do with this data. If I am giving you a set of 10 numbers, you should know what you are supposed to do with those 10 numbers. So with this comes, there are certain techniques which we applied on data for performing some sort of data analysis. So let us see what all we can do with the data. So as I told you, that data analysis is more important here. And where does this data come from generally? As I told you, we collect the data through various sources. We do the survey, we can download from the website, there might be documents, the query from the database, and there is certain data which we share online also as users, and a lot of data is available online. So that is called data footprint. When we browse a website, when we search for certain products, daily we spend some time on social media platforms, what we do, we share our information knowingly or unknowingly. So that is called data footprint. And that data is very important for businesses out there. They can figure from this data how it is useful for them. The data which we share online knowingly and unknowingly tells them what are my likings and dislikings, what are my preferences, who am I, what kind of profession I am in. So all this information, actually my age group, what is my circle about, who all are my friends. So this all helps the businesses to devise this marketing strategy to sell you and to promote their products to you and do targeted marketing. So this is what data footprint does, then we all know from our experience that data is variable in nature. Basically, data is either in numerical form or in categorical form. Categorical form, for example, gender, male and female, name of the department. Numerical is all the numbers, the amount, the height, weight, age. These all are numerical figures. Then in categorical, if we talk about processing the data in terms of artificial intelligence, then there is a lot of complex data also there. For example, images. In artificial intelligence, the applications are able to identify images or process images in different ways. So image is a complex data type. Facial recognition is one example where image processing is used. This technology, this technique is called, in artificial intelligence, it is called computer vision. Then another kind of complex data is natural language, which we humans speak. Natural language is spoken. The language might be coming from a scanned page also. So that is also an example of data type, another kind of data. So not only numbers and figures and text, there could be images, there could be spoken word, that is audio, there could be multimedia. This all makes for the data for an artificial intelligence application. Well, when we talk about data, when we come across data, there are two aspects of data, quantitative and qualitative. Quantitative data is all the numeric data which either can be measured or it can be counted. How many or how much? That is what quantitative relates to. How many and how much is the data? How many students have scored distinction? Or how much is the price of top five items? So how much the measurement and counting is done with the quantitative data, which is mostly numeric data. Counting can be done of non-numeric data also. How many male candidates applied for the job? How many female candidates have applied for the job? So there, we are counting a non-numeric data. Then qualitative data, description or subjective. For example, names of people and cities. All the data which is shared on the social website, the reviews from the customers, this all is descriptive or subjective data. That is also considered for analysis depending on the business requirement. Now, as I told you, that data is available. What all can we do with the data? Actually, what happens, a data scientist asks questions from the data. When we look at some data, there are certain questions we are looking the answers for. So what kind of questions we can ask from the data? One very basic question is predicting something, whether this year the drought will be happening or not, the flood will happen or not. So yes or no type of questions, this will happen or not. The product will be sold, the product will be bought by the customer or not. The product will be returned by the customers or not. So these kind of questions can be asked. Then looking for certain anomalies, certain which is out of the routine, that's called odd one out, something which is out of normal. Now this is one typical example is the payments in the bank, in financial organizations. In a particular account, a regular payment is being done and suddenly in one transaction the figure is very high. Now this is something out of normal, so the attention will go on that particular figure and we try to figure out why this happened, from where this figure has come from, what is the reason. Bank alerts the customer that this much amount has been deposited or withdrawn from your account. Was it you? So this is called detecting something which is unusual in normal routine. That is one aspect from data. Then as I told you, how much and how many. We want to count. We want to take an estimate. We want to do measurement. Then we try to answer the questions how much and how many type of questions. Then we try to group the data. Sometimes we try to group the data. Grouping the data means out of those data values, I analyze certain features in the data, and depending on that feature, I segregate the values in different forms, in different groups. For example, on the basis of grouping, I can, on the basis of gender, I can group the data. On the basis of marks, I can group the data. Then grouping the data depending on certain criteria, depending on certain property of the data. As I told you, gender, marks could be there. Now grouping can be in two ways. Grouping on the basis of certain property or grouping on the basis of similar properties. People staying in same area, people living in same city, students belonging to the same section, students who have scored same marks. This kind of grouping is called clustering. So we can cluster the data, or depending on certain criteria, when we are grouping the data values, that is called classification. So this we can do. Then we try to predict also. Sometimes we need to predict. Now prediction is always done by looking at the historical data. So if you're looking at the salary of an employee of past 2 years, then you will see the pattern of increment in the salary and other factors like how long he has been working with the company, in what role he was working with the company, what all facilities were available. Considering all these factors, you can predict, okay, after 6 months, this person should be earning this much amount in salary. So this is called predicting something out of the present data. So whatever data historically is available, we look at it, try to find out some pattern out of it, and then we try to predict what could be. One typical example I would take in your academic field, suppose you are looking at the question papers of past 10 years. And out of that past 10 years analysis of question papers, you are asked to create one question paper, one sample question paper out of those question papers. And then you want to see in actual exam, how many questions have been asked, which were there in your question paper also. So what you are trying to do is you are trying to predict the question paper. You are trying to forecast, okay, on this topic, this question will come. And when the actual paper comes in the board exam, you can compare whether that question really had come or not. So this is one example of doing predictions or forecasts. Besides forecast, what we do is sometimes we take decisions what to do next. Now that completely comes in the domain of reinforced learning. Now reinforced learning is slightly different from data science field. It is more towards artificial intelligence, where we talk about certain very smart machines who can move around, making their own way, who can figure out the route to reach from point A to point B. For example, a robot which is working in a factory, and that robot should know what are the obstacles it should avoid and what is the way it should take. So if that robot is going to run on an AI algorithm, that robot has to be taught about that movement in the factory around. A self-driven car is a very complex and very sophisticated example of reinforced learning. That is done by trial and error method. By failing again and again, and by passing in certain steps, the machine learns from failures, and whatever passes it earns, whatever marks it earns, whatever marks it loses on failure, learning happens, a learning pattern is developed, and depending on that learning pattern, that machine behaves. So that is called reinforced learning, which is not much towards data science. So data science primarily focuses on answering certain questions, as I told you. How much, how many measurements, yes, no, predicting something out of looking at the historical data, categorizing the values in different ways. This is the forte of data science. And that needs quite good analytical skills, because there are many things which you may overlook in a data set if you're new to the data set. And as you practice more, you will have that insight. When you look at the data set, you can look at the picture which it is trying to show you. So moving on to the practical aspect of it, what all we do with the data. So as you see here, we will touch at various aspects of this data analytics, which makes the basics of data science. The very basics are actually mode, mean, and median. These three terms you might have come across, you might be knowing about them also, and you might be teaching in data science sessions to the students. If you have not, you can discuss with these terms, because that makes a very basic of statistics and mathematics of data science. Data science is nothing but more of statistics and this mathematics part. So if you look at this, I show you how do we analyze data just by looking at one aspect of data, that is called mode. Mode is actually the frequency of a term in the data set. For example, how many times, you see the counting has happened here. How many times a number is appearing in a particular data set. So if you can see this screen over here, you see here, this is a data set of certain marks out of 20 for certain topics in HTML, HTML basics, HTML table, and HTML form. In these three topics, the teacher has taken the exam, and out of 20, the marks have been given here. Now, when we talk about mode, we talk about how many times a number has appeared in the data set. If you talk about this HTML basic formatting, you see 1, 2, 3, 4. 11 is appearing 4 times. So the mode here is 4, but 12 is also appearing 2 times. So in what will happen, it's not necessary that one particular value would be multiple times. There would be more than one value. So such a data set is called bimodal or multimodal data set. So here also, if you see, this is a single mode data set. Only 7 is repeated 3 times. So the mode is 3 here. Here 8 is repeated many times, 1, 2, 3, 4 times. So the mode here is 4. Now just by the mode, how can we do analyze and do useful analysis with the data? So here teacher is analyzing the data. How many students have scored marks less than 8? How many students have scored marks between 8 and 12? And how many students have scored the marks above 12? So here teacher has made a sheet, a small sheet of analysis. This is the result of analysis from this data set. So teacher can easily figure out, okay, here teacher can easily find out on which topic that teacher has to focus more. And that is HTML table. Mostly the student have not understood. 6 students have performed below 8 score for HTML table. HTML basic formatting is quite in control. Class is going to perform well in that, in test. HTML table has to be explained again. And HTML form is also in control with little bit of rework. HTML forms can also be explained to the students again. But HTML table needs the much focus on explanation again to the students. So this is just by looking at the mode of the data, this analysis has come. Similarly, the teacher has also made a graph. You see this graph. This is called box whisker graph. Box whisker graph has a box and whisker like protuberance you can see here. So if you see this graph that is made on these three topics, marks gained by the student, you will see in HTML basic formatting here, two of the points, number 19 and number 5, are very far from the actual data set. These values which are lying very far on the graph are called outliers. Outliers are those values which are exceptional, which are up to the extreme point, either very high or very low, towards minimum or maximum. So that means one student is performing very bad, very poorly in your exam. And at the other end, one student is performing excellent, outstanding in your exam. Now, these two students are actually balancing out your result. So these two students are out, these two marks are outliers. Let us see here also. 12, 13, 19 is one student has gained 19 and another is 5. In this data set, if you see, there is no outliers. This is a very well balanced scoring in HTML table. But if we look at HTML form, one student has gained 17 out of 20. And that is actually improving your average score of the class. That looks very good. That because of one student, your score is very well maintained. So these are the things, the outliers have to be analyzed. Because of outlier, your score is improving because the student did well. This could have been reversed also. Because of one student, your average might have gone down also. So outliers have to be considered, have to be identified. And whenever you are analyzing the data, in most of the cases, you need to get rid of outliers. Remove the outliers and then analyze the data. That will give you the correct picture of the data. So mean mode is one aspect where you can count, and you can, this is one example I have given you, how you analyze the data by the help of mode, and how the outliers are seen on the extent of the graph. Outliers are those values which are visible on the extreme of the data set. These are the extremely high or extremely low values. Then another aspect of data science is mean. Mean is simply the average of the values, and averages are always deceptive. As I told you, one student has performed very high, the result, the average result of that teacher would be very good. But what about the teacher whose one student has just performed, one or two students have performed very poorly? Then entire average of the students is spoiled. Your average result is gone down just because of a few students. So here what we should not rely on means. Means are very deceptive. What should we do in that case? That is something called measuring the central tendency. Central tendency means the middle figures of your data. How do you get the middle figures of the data set? You go for something called median. When you sort the data like this, you see this data, the same data is there. I have sorted this, and this is what the mean, 11.4, 7.6, 9.4 is the mean. What is the median? Median is the distribution of the middle figure. You sort the data and see the middlemost value. How many values are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Out of 10 values, the value 6 and 7, these are the two values which are in the middle of the data set. Then you sort it. So if there are two values in the middle, the number of rows is actually even. So you will get two values in the middle. You take the average. So actual mean is 11. So your performance is 11, and your student, one student has performed very well. You can tell them. Similarly, here the mean is 7. Median is 7, sorry. And here the median is 8. So median tells you the central tendency of the data, how many figures are closer to your middle median value. If you look at this data set, 11 is the middle value, and 9, 11, 11, 11, 11, 12, 12, 13. So how many of these are there? 8. 8 values are there which are closer to the median. So these 8 values are actually important to show the teacher's performance. Teacher should say that I will consider these values to analyze my results. The other two values are outliers. They are too low or too high. So this is how median will tell you how many values are closer to the median. More values are closer to the median, better is your data set, better is your result. Another aspect of data science, out of a data set, when you're looking at it, you look for the range. Range means the difference between the minimum value and the maximum value. So minimum value could be lowest marks in your classroom, maximum, the maximum marks, you take the difference. The difference of minimum and maximum values are called range. For example, if you see here, in this is the result of two sections of a class, section A, section B. Both the classes have given the exam for these topics. These 10 topics are there, and they have given the exam. Different marks are there. Their average is same. Now, if somebody is looking at the average of both the sections, they will say, okay, both the sections have performed equally well or equally bad. But is this really true? If you look at the data, what is the maximum marks gained in section A? That is 16. And in section B, the maximum marks, somebody has got 100% marks, 20 out of 20. So this seems to be better. Minimum marks, but again, another aspect is the poor performance is also there in section B. Section B has got the best performer also and the poor performer also. So when you look at these kind of values, averages are not important then. What becomes important? The range, the median, which becomes important. So both the at first look, both the performances are looking the same. But look at the range. See the difference. The difference is almost double. Now you are tend to analyze the data deeper. So you will see in the graph also, 20 is the maximum mark. For this section B, orange color is section B. See, a lot of difference is there. Almost double the difference is there in the performances. See? This makes the difference. In HTML 12, the maximum marks here are 12. Here, maximum marks is 20. So this way you can analyze the two sections, two performances, depending on the maximum value, minimum value, that is the difference is range and the median. So this is how we look, this is the importance of range. So we have mode, we have mean, we have median and range of the data. So here range is same, but still we see some difference. Here average is same, but range is quite different. Now another aspect, I have made a different graph on the same data set. Look at the graph. I have made the graph of average and the marks. The average marks is 9. The mean is 9. And I have plotted it against the individual marks of the student. So this is the marks of section A around 9. Where is 9? 9 is here somewhere. See, this is 9. This is 9. If you compare these two graphs, you will see that section B has not performed very well here in this particular case. Most of the values which are less than 9 are falling on the left hand side below 9. And this data set is quite distributed. This is a balanced data set, but this data set, we have low performance in section B. So I have to focus more, I have to do more hard work with section B. And see, the averages are same. Averages are same, but the reality is different. One section is good balanced performer and one section has more poor performers. That is why data visualization is important. So when you look at the data by the help of graph, if you see here, you look at the data through graph, you can visually figure out that here this section B is performing well. In this case, see the higher values, higher columns are there. But in this case, the section B is doing poorly. You have to focus more on section B. Now, another aspect, my averages are same and my range is also same. Another interesting scenario. Abhi tak, what I was telling you that agar average aapka same hai, if your average is same, go for checking the range. So that you can analyze the data better, you can identify the outliers. But here the range is also same. See here, average is same, range is also 17. But if you look at the graph, it's still, if you look at 9 here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 poor performers are there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 poor performers are in section A. Here section A is has more poor performance as compared to section B. So visualizing the data through a graph is also important. Only analytical figures will not help you. Visualize the data through different graphs. Look at these graphs. Here, if you look at the graph of section B, there is no outlier at the lower end. At the lower end, maximum, how many marks have gone? 3, 2, 1 is there. Okay, 1 is also there. Minimum 3 marks have gone. 3 students have got 3 marks. But most of the marks are nearer to the median, nearer to the average. Fine. But if you look at this graph, section A graph, section A graph is clearly showing outlier on the lower end also. Mark 1, mark 2. So these are the red areas. These are the students to whom you have to, on whom you have to focus more. or these are the topics you have to explain in the class again to improve the performance. So this is how, with the help of outliers and comparing the data through graphs, you can better analyze the data through data science. Now, what is the use of data science here? When we look at the outliers, we can remove the outliers and keep the data which is closer to the median, and that data is appropriate to feed into an AI algorithm. Another aspect is there might be some missing values. There could be some students who have not given the exam. We cannot put zero there. Zero will again spoil the average and entire calculation. So for those missing values, there has to be some null value, or they should not be considered for the performance analysis. So missing values have to be taken care of. Outliers spoil the data analysis. So you have to take care of outlier, whether to keep them or not. Similarly, there is another aspect called standard deviation. Standard deviation is another technique in data science to find out which of the values are closer to the median. This is very useful when you take the median. Again, I take the same example. The marks are there of a section in various topics over here. The average is 11. However, certain students have done very well, 20. And one student has done very poorly, outlier, 3, 20. But still, average is 11. Now, how do we calculate standard deviation? First of all, how do we use standard deviation? Suppose I calculate a standard deviation of this data set, whatever it is, X, Y, Z. I compare the standard deviation with the average or the median value. It should be close, as much closer to the average it is. The data set is well formed, the data set is well balanced. So how do we calculate the standard deviation? To calculate the standard deviation, first of all, we calculate the variance. Variance is deviation of the distribution of the data and how the average is deviating, how far the average is from the actual value. How do we do that? First of all, we take the average of all the values here, that is 11. And then from each value, from 5, from 12, from 6, I deduct this average. 5 minus 11, 12 minus 11, 6 minus 11, like this. So you might get certain negative values also. To make those values positive, we take the square of them. Here I have taken the square of these values. And then the average of the square is taken. So what you see here is squared mean. This is the squared mean of these values. What is the squared mean? The difference between the actual value minus the average of all the values. Actual value minus average value, and then its square has been done. The average of all the squares is called variance. So take the step number one, take the average of the value, entire data set. Step number two, from each value, deduct the average value. Step number three, make a square of all these differences. Step number four, take the average of all these squared values. And in step number five, we calculate standard deviation. Step number five is take the square root of the variance. So when you take the square root of variance, you get a standard deviation. So standard deviation is nothing but the square root of variance. And here the variance is 6.2. And if I take the median, see, I have taken the median of this data set. This data set I have taken out here, it is sorted here. And when I sort the data set, median values are 8 and 12. The average of 8 and 12 is 10. 10 is the median, 6.2 is the standard deviation. So how many values are closer to standard deviation? You can say 5, 6, 8, 12 is quite far off. So 5, 6, 8 are nearer to the standard deviation. But these values are farther from standard deviation. But in terms of marks, this is a good news. Higher the mark, better is the performance. So here, if the standard deviation is lower and higher marks are away from the standard deviation, it's a good performance. So in this particular context, if a standard deviation is away from the higher value, that is a positive sign. But if a standard deviation is away from the lower value, that's a bad performance. So a standard deviation gives you accurate estimate of your performance if you are able to calculate the median also. So where did we start from? We started from mode, the frequency of the values in a data set. Then we came down to range. We came down to average. We discovered how deceptive the average is. Average never tells the clear story because of outliers. Because of outliers, average will be faulty. So you eliminate the outliers. How do you identify the outliers? You identify the outliers by the help of maximum and minimum values, the range. You plot the graph. On the graph, you can clearly see the outlier values. You reject them, you remove them. And then you focus on the median part, the middle distribution of your data. So how the data is distributed across is very important. If data is not evenly distributed, that data is not useful for AI algorithm. So median has to be calculated, and your data values, if they are closer to the median, it's a very well balanced data set. So any values which are falling closer to median is a good data set. And when you analyze with standard deviation in different contexts, a higher standard deviation or a lower standard deviation could be a good or bad performance depending on the context. And how did we calculate the standard deviation? Of all the values in data set, we take the average. We take the difference between the actual value and the average value. We square it. We take the average of all the squared differences, that is variance. And then we go for the standard deviation, which is the square root of the variance. This is how standard deviation tells us how data is distributed, how data is evenly distributed across in your data set. So friends, here I have given you a quick glimpse of data science, some very basic fundamentals, how you intercept the data and how you look at the data with different angles. And graphs play a very important role. There are certain things which I have not told you, like distribution of the data. You can create a pie chart which will show you the slices, and you can figure out the performance out of the pie chart. That's called distribution of the data. So basically in data science, what happens is we look at the data and apply certain techniques. Those techniques are actually statistical techniques. One very basic is mode. Mode will always tell you certain very realistic things, like popularity of certain things. How popular is this brand in the market? How you can find out by counting the reviews of the customer. Sentiment analysis. We do sentiment analysis of the public, the celebrities and the leaders, the political leaders, they do sentiment analysis. Huge data is collected, that is called big data. Big data means a variety of complex data which is generated at every moment. A huge volume of data is collected by sophisticated machines. They analyze it and then they figure out whether the sentiments are in the favor of the person or are against the person. So how many likes and dislikes are there? How many times the product has been rejected or returned? How many times the product has been purchased or promoted by the customers to their friends? So this all comes into what we call mode will help you in that. So simple mode can help you run your business in a better direction. Then we learned about how the average, I will not take much time, more than 5 to 10 minutes, and how much the data is useful when we look at it in terms of average. Now, average, as we saw, average never tells you the correct story. So you sort the data and you go for the middle value, the median. Always calculate the median. And from that median, you try to figure out what all figures are closer to the median. Those figures are actual figures to be analyzed. And the moment you sort the data, and you create a graph, you can clearly see what are the outliers which are either showing me a very high performance, which is not true, or showing me a very poor performance, which is also not true. So maybe in one region 100 customers have bought your product and in another region only 2 customers have bought your product. You cannot boast that you have got a very good sale. Average will be good, but what are the median figures? What are the real figures? How the data is distributed? So you go for the centralization of the data. Then you see how the data is distributed. If you are preparing the data for artificial intelligence algorithm, now that AI algorithm has to be trained by the data. So data science techniques, what I have shown you, they are used in finding out the training data set. You know, training data set is that data which is used to train the algorithm. Now that data set should not have missing values. That data set should not have outliers, maximum or minimum values. Because what will happen? Because of these outliers, the AI model will learn something called, it will develop something called bias, favoritism, or against. So outliers should be avoided because they generate bias. They generate unfairness. So data science techniques, mean, median, mode, standard deviation, these all are useful in tidying up the data for artificial intelligence algorithms. So those, when we are teaching code 417, artificial intelligence in our classroom, the initial chapters in class 8, class 9, class 10, class 8 completely is dealing with data science actually, and it is touching the basics of artificial intelligence. But in class 9 and class 10, the initial part is actually talking about tidying up the data. How the data has to be analyzed manually. How the data has to be analyzed by the help of a simple tool like MS Excel, like I showed you. So you need MS Excel in the first phase of your book. You can use samples and show to the students. You can ask them the questions. Like you can tell them, okay, class, you can give them a scenario. Okay, in annual festival, there will be an annual fair where all the where there will be food stalls. Now you have to decide what food should I sell so that my stall gets a big sale. Should I sell burgers or the chola bhaturas or the ice cream? What should I do? So people generally, what they do, they generally put all the popular products, food items, and they try to sell. But what you did is you did a survey. You did a whole school survey asking one question from each student, that what do you like to eat? Which fast food is your favorite? One single question. Which fast food is your favorite? Out of these 10, you have given them the choice. Out of these 10, which one is the favorite of yours? Now, when you collect all the data, put it in Excel, by calculating, by sorting it, by calculating average, mean, median, by looking at the mode, just by looking at the mode, you can figure out, okay, burgers are most popular. So you will try to figure out, okay, top three counts are this, burger, chola bhature, and ice cream. I will keep these three. And I bet that would be a good sale because you have done an intelligent analysis of the survey data. This is what marketing companies, this is what businesses do out there. They capture all our data from social sites, from their website, from surveys, from our reviews, from our sentiments. And by analyzing all this, applying these techniques, they make decisions whether this product has to be launched, in which month this project has to be launched. The umbrellas will always be launched in rainy season. In those particular 3-4 months, sale would be higher. Or in hot season, black umbrellas will not do. The fancy colorful umbrellas for ladies will do because they purchase colorful umbrellas. So colorful light umbrellas will sell in hot months. Black, no nonsense umbrellas will sell in the months which are rainy season months. And in winter, the sale will go down. So this is how they analyze just by mode. And standard deviation always tells you how tidy is your data, how evenly it is distributed from the middle of your data set. Closer the data set, data value, better is the data to analyze. Better that would be the data for an artificial intelligence for its training. Because once the AI algorithm is trained in that data, it will be able to analyze on the basis of that training only. in real life, it is going to get some data and it will process that data depending on the training which it has got from this data set which you had analyzed. So your data has to be very well balanced, well formed. No missing value should be there. Data has to be relevant. No outlier should be there. And data should be evenly distributed so that there is no bias when your AI algorithm actually processes the real life data. There should not be bias result, which may lead to some loss, which may lead to some unprecedented situation, which may lead to some unexpected result. So this is the purpose of data analysis, as I told you, to tidy up the data for AI algorithm and to analyze the data to see the story being told by the data. Like you saw in our 10 mark scenario, that was a very small data set. Think of 1,000 figures, then mean, median, mode, standard deviation, so many charts. One chart will tell you one thing, the other chart will tell you the other thing. Percentages, percentage distribution, pie chart will tell you. But when you are going to compare, that will be done by the bar chart or column chart. If you want to see the outliers immediately in one glance, you will go for box whisker chart. If you want to see the proper distribution of the data, you might go for area chart. If you want to see the trend in the data for predicting something, you will go for line chart or scatter chart. In a scatter chart, the line chart will never be a straight line, but out of that dwindling, out of that zigzag line, if you draw a straight line, you can figure, you can predict which will be the next figure. You can do predictions by the help of line charts and scatter charts. By the help of scatter charts, if you see the data values on the chart, you can draw the circle and simply find out which all figures are closer to each other. The similar figures are closer to each other. That's called clustering. What you are doing, you are grouping the similar values together in a group. You are doing the clustering. So if you're putting the data values, depending on the, suppose you want to find out who all have got distinction marks in your class. So you will go for data filtering. Data filtering can be easily done in Excel. So just by filtering the data or putting some criteria on the data, you can figure out who all are star performers, who are the students on whom you don't have to work hard with whom, and who are the poor performers. And with those, you have to develop the strategy for revision. So this is how you analyze the data. The data has to be analyzed in two aspects, whether the data showing me a picture which is good for me, or whether the data is showing me the picture which is bad for me. If the picture is bad for me, what all measures should I take to make the picture good? And if it is good for me, how can I utilize this picture for earning more, for better performance? This is only the purpose of data science and artificial intelligence. So friends, once again, thank you all of you to be with me in this evening. And I really hope whatever little bit you are able to take this from this session, that will definitely be useful for you somewhere. And I suggest you watch all other recordings on our channel also. There are many other recordings talking about various topics on data science and AI. So those, watching those will also help you. So watching those all together will develop your understanding about the subject in a better way. So thank you once again, all of you. Have a nice evening.